at 6:53 p.m. Do notice having been posted. For the beginning, we'll do a roll call with any members present, knowing we have a couple more coming on, and we'll announce them when they come in. So, begin the roll call of members.
Rick Pierce.
Jamal Mosley.
John Gallagher.
Carlos Campos.
Jameson Souza.
Mark Furtado.
Stephanie Field. Julie Gagliardi.
Chance the maker. And what we'll do is, until we get to the quorum number, this will be strictly informational, and we'll ask for a beginning of the review of the FF&E and the furnishing. Dr. Mosley.
Okay. Just real quick. I'm not going to do too long, long presentation per se. I'm going to talk a little bit about the FF&E, and then we can open up the discussion, and then Nancy's going to jump in. This is Nancy Laurel from, you work with AI3, or you actually own your own business, is that correct? All right. And Nancy and I have been communicating for about the last year and a half on FF&E and trying to get this process together. You know, just FF&E is really from the genesis of the program of study, the technology requirements, the mission of the school, the NEAS report, departments' priorities. Many departments wanted many different specific things in their areas. They wanted nice furniture for their common areas. They wanted different types of equipment for the labs, and they wanted connectivity for their laptops and computers. The FF&E is part of the MSBA requirements. Meaning that we had to follow the space summary. Back in July of 2011, we sat down and wrote a space summary that was consistent with the MSBA space occupancy formula and programs of study. If you remember, we tried to get an auditorium of 1,000 students, but the MSBA said no. We had to go with 850, and certainly it's a requirement that we had to follow. So most of our FF&E has been prescribed by the MSBA, as well as our programs of study. Specific requirements for room and location. Some of our rooms and locations vary from floor to floor and from classroom to classroom. For instance, we in our original plan, what we tried to do is that we tried to have all of the special education classrooms on the first floor, very close to the nurse's office. We couldn't do that because from the MSBA perspective, they wanted the classrooms spread out throughout the entire building. So even though it's not functional, it's something that we had to do. So when we look at FF&E, please understand that each classroom is very different, very specific, and we need to have strict guidelines in terms of order of furniture. So the FF&E is really based on using space differently in the new building, going green, specialized rooms, common area, library supports many different venues, online learning, virtual learning, small group instruction, media center, lounge seating areas. You don't see that here in this library whatsoever, but the new library that we're going to have is certainly going to have that capacity to do so. It's a very different concept. It's not a library that we grew up with, but it's certainly a library where it promotes group learning. It promotes kind of what we want to really simulate is a college atmosphere for our students to prepare them for where they want to be in post-secondary education, as well as the military and in the workforce as well. All right. So I'm going to give a brief timeline. I think it's very important. In the fall of 2011, we discussed the preliminary FF&E, discussions about the space and equipment. In the winter, last spring of 2012, we reviewed the space and the building design with the content coordinators. Myself, Troy was involved in that, Nancy was involved in that, Brian was involved in that. And I want to stress, these were numerous meetings. These weren't just one meetings or two meetings. These were several meetings of just refining the space. It wasn't, the general classrooms are pretty set, because that's just according to the MSBA. But when you're looking at special education classrooms, when you're looking at the CAD labs, when you're looking at the business department, we're still in discussion around the foreign language department. When you look at very specific departments, the FF&E becomes a little bit more complicated than just a general classroom. Looking at science equipment, right now we have to determine what types of science equipment are transferable over and what's not. We're not deciding, we've already decided that. but certainly it doesn't, it's not just one meeting, but it's a series of meetings and emails and conversations. John Gallagher and I have been working on this. Thank you, John, for all of your support around this. Content coordinators have been involved in this, other teachers, and what I mean by other teachers, particularly around in the science department, we've had several meetings with the biology department. Then we had several meetings with the physics department. So in the new building, there's a difference between a biology room and a physics room, but you have to make sure that you have the FF&E equipment that fits that particular room. Summer 2013, we reviewed the FF&E from other districts to understand what qualifies under the FF&E. We had a work sample from Hingham, Norwood, Natick. Please understand that these, all right.
I was just here 20 minutes ago for a basketball game.
All right, so now we're doing business.
Say
one. We looked at different high schools for what qualified for FF&E. And again, please understand, what qualified in Norwood doesn't necessarily qualify us here at the high school. Again, going back to what I said before, our programs of study, the MSBA, we use those as a guide, but certainly knowing what other schools did and what they identify FF&E was very, very helpful. The fall of 2013, we did a walkthrough assessment of the FF&E here at the school. Some of our school committee members, Assistant Principal Brelsford, also did a walkthrough of East Bridgewater to see some of the things that they had for their FF&E and what they ordered. Fall 2013, as you notice, some of you are sitting in the furniture right now. Some of the furniture that is going to go in the new building, our faculty, our PTO, our SAC members, administration had a chance, and students, more importantly, to sit and pilot some of this furniture. I use the word pilot, but maybe that's not the word I want to select. Maybe test run, see that? I don't know what
test,
the word is.
Yeah.
Test experiment with. But anyway, we had an opportunity to appreciate the difference between this desk and this desk. All right, so what I did is that this is the part where I was going to turn it over to Nancy a little bit and actually have her, for all of you to take a look at the document that's in front of you. Just explaining the budget, explaining the different markups and how that is communicated. And certainly once we're running through, once we're done with this, we can certainly open up for questions and discussion. Is that fair enough?
Basically, what we do, our process is to put a program together, and this is the FF&E program for your school. This is a summary of the costs, and one of the things we try to do is assign budgets to staff members, but what we find is that the MSBA doesn't allow reimbursement on enough money that we can do the school soup to nuts. So one of the things Jamal wanted to see was what the teachers really needed in the school. So that's how we ended up at 2.172. What I want to explain to you, what I do in my budgeting process, is the number that MSBA is reimbursing you for is 1.6. So what I do, because what I'm dealing with are vendors who are not giving me bid numbers, they're giving me budget numbers, is I work with a 20% margin of error. And I do that for a couple reasons, because if we start this job 2 years ago, which we really did start it then, because we started working with the architect for spatial and electrical, we start putting the program together then. And what I don't know is what the bidding climate's gonna be 2 years out. Because what happened when the banks went down in 2008 made 2010 the most aggressive buying period, because no one had really sold a whole lot between the time the banks went down in 2010 and then the economy started going back up again. So what we're in right now is an inflationary spiral in that steel is costing more, which means the building is costing more, which means building a desk is costing more. Raw materials cost more now. So I can give pretty good estimates, but what I do is I basically tack on a 20% margin of error, knowing that some of my numbers are going to be high and some of my numbers are going to be low, and they're going to, the average out is going to balance out. And as an example, last fall we did a job in East Hampton, and they had 600 and some, it was a very small high school, 500 kids, tiny. They had $600,000 to spend, 617, and they wrote $1 million program. And I told them that that program was going to come in at $800,000, and it came into the nickel at $800,000. They thought if they, it's a bid, so we're going to buy more because we're going to get better pricing, blah, blah, blah. But people will only work to a certain number. They're not going to work for free. And I tried to explain that to them. And sure enough, it came. Their million-dollar program did not come in at $600. It came in at $800,000. So I'm pretty comfortable with my markup, knowing that as a mean, I'm going to be okay. So you guys right now are over where you need to be in order to hit that, because with a 20% markup, we want to be at 192. You guys are at 2172. So what we've done is Dr. Mosley, John, and I, we sat with the committee and we basically took out enough stuff to get it down to like 198. But then we put it back in. So we know if we put this on the street now, there's ways that we can get the number down. One is to write alternates. As an example, this is the preferred desk that they like to use because it works better with a laptop than the old-fashioned desk that we were using 5 and 6 years ago. So what we can do, and we've done it on other schools, is we can write this is our preferred desk and this is our alternate, and get pricing on both. And then when the numbers come in, you can make a judgment. Do you want to spend more or do you want to stay at 1.6? Same thing with the chairs. The hard plastic chairs are going to cost less than the soft plastic chairs. And the advantage of this chair over the hard plastic chair is its functionality relative to working on a desk. So the custodians don't have to pick the desk up and turn it over. They can basically connect it to the desk for cleaning. This is the new chair. We've put this chair in Natick. We put the other chair similar to this in Plymouth. They're both on the street. They both have 15-year warranties. This is right now our preferred chair, and then the less expensive chair is going back to the hard plastic, which, so again, we can write it in as an alternate. We can probably save $80,000 if we need to by buying the old-fashioned furniture. There are other cuts we can make, such as wrestling mats. We've got over $30,000 in wrestling mats in the program, wrestling and cheerleading mats. So those can come out if they have to. So basically, there's a couple other ways we can try to save money with the furniture too, and we're going to do all that to put it on the street and see where it comes in. One of the things, as it seems like blue smoke and mirrors right now, but when the numbers come in from the bids, those are real numbers. And I'll be able, with my database, there are three documents I bring you when I bring the bid analysis. One is the bid analysis. One is justifications, because if I make an award that's not a low bid, I have to justify why. And you don't want to buy stuff that isn't up to quality, that's going to fall apart. So I can always justify throwing out a low bidder if I need to. And the third thing is an award summary. And an award summary is a calculation of everything that we're recommending you guys purchase. So when I come to you with that analysis, and I come to you with my recommendation, it won't be blue smoke and mirrors anymore. It'll be a hard number, and it'll be real. So we don't work in Excel. It's a database. So if it's input correctly, it comes out correct. And I'll be able to tell you that night where we are dollar-wise. Another thing we will do in the beginning of this, when the numbers come in, is I actually do, it's an unqualified bid award. I basically look at who my normal players are and what I'm getting from those guys. And I basically will, just to get a number quicker than, you know, 3 weeks into doing the analysis, in about a week I'll be able to give you a ballpark number of where we are with an unqualified award. That means that I've got to go through the process of qualifying it. It's not going to change that much. It'll tell you where you are for the volume of stuff that you're buying. So that's a capability we have too. So what we're going to do, if you guys approve it, is put it out on the street the way it is, knowing that we can delete or add, and we can also buy alternates if they're specified in the document.
May I add one caveat to that, Nancy?
Mm-hmm.
And I just want the committee to know that we did go through a vetting process. We did do a walkthrough through the building. Part of that had to do with myself, Nancy, John, and Rich Fensermaker. We walked through the building just to see if any of the furniture in the current building was salvageable. The majority of it is not. You're looking at desks that are about 15 years old. That are pretty, we use them in all of our regular classroom, our English classrooms, our some of our science classrooms, all of our academic classrooms. This is a typical desk you see here. These file cabinets are not transferable over. There's a couple of things, other things that you need to know. Our wrestling mats have seen better days. If you were to take these mats out, you know, our kids, and none of my kids wrestle whatsoever, personal kids, but certainly these mats have seen better days. It's not something that, in my opinion, that is appropriate for our kids. And when we make the request for new wrestling mats, please understand that these mats have already been cleaned, resurfaced, cleaned to the max, and they've seen, despite all of that, we need new mats. That's it. I don't know how to say it. It's bad for those mats, for those kids. Some of this, I want to call your attention. This is our course chairs, our band chairs. Yes, they're absolutely new. Yes, they're beautiful. Yes, if you look at them and you say, hey, you know what? Those chairs are pretty good and they can be transferred over. They actually cannot be transferred over only because they don't meet current fire code and they're not appropriate for the new building. So we can't transfer them over because they don't meet current fire code for our new building. This is our current athletic wellness center. You know, that stuff is not transferable over whatsoever. It's seen better days. We don't want to bring that over, and we certainly don't want our kids using it in the new building. So please understand, when we are making these requests, and the allocation of the MSBA is at 1.6, and we're over that. It's not that we're trying to live heavy off the hog or anything like that, but this is our current reality for our kids. What we did here at the high school, as I shared with you before, we piloted the current equipment you see in front of us. Our kids gave us some feedback. Our teachers gave us some feedback. These are some different desk samples that we piloted here. Our faculty and students in PTO. We got some of our kids just giving us some feedback as well. Writing capacity, electronic device capacity, student comfort. They found that these desks were much more comfortable. They wanted to be at a desk. I mean, they wanted to be seated at these desks here with that particular chair. We did a compare and contrast. The two finalists were this desk and that desk. Certainly, there's some differences in terms of what desk people prefer. Yes, I put the Klingon. Is it Star Trek people? No? All right. I call this the Klingon desk, but this is more, Nancy told me this is the stealth desk. Okay. But there's always some positive and negatives about the desks. As you can tell, these desks are much more flexible than those desks, and certainly this was the preferred one. Our faculty sat in some of our desks and gave us some feedback as well. So again, I just want to reiterate, there's very limited furniture that can be transferred over. Some of our students there. I wanted just to get to the timeline. So we're asking for support of the FF&E as described by Nancy. Please understand that this is a process that is equivalent to moving into a new house. We can't predict everything that's going to go wrong here or anything like that. It's like moving into a new house. You actually have to get into the house to really understand what it needs, but we have a good idea how we want to furnish the house. This is a timeline for installation, and that's actually located on your sheet right here. So you can certainly take a look at that. And that's basically it for the presentation for the FF&E.
So just as a point of clarification, on the MSBA reimbursable piece of this is $1.2 million is the reimbursable. And then our current budget was, you know, the budget that we went into this year was $1.6. So we had $400,000 that we knew was not reimbursable coming into this. Mm-hmm. And where we are now, just as a point of direction, I guess, is we don't have to approve the final numbers per se at tonight's meeting, but give some feedback to as far as the bid goes, because what they're looking for tonight is just approval to go out to bid with the program as it is. Adjustments can be made at a later date, or if the committee chooses to give some direction tonight, that on how that might work, that's open as well, too. So I guess with that, I'll open up to any questions.
Just a comment, Mayor. Going out to bid does not obligate this committee or the school district to purchase it. It simply provides you with numbers that you can make decisions on.
30B has guideline. You can go up or down 25%.
Right.
So you have the capability to do that.
But then I, by letting you go out to bid, then I obligate to purchase everything you go out to bid for.
Right.
Within the 30B guideline, 25% up or down.
No, but like, you wouldn't have to award a contract.
You don't have to award a contract.
If you go out to bid and for whatever reason you went out to bid, you're not obligated to award a contract.
That's correct.
I had a couple of questions. On that presentation, there was a line that said that it didn't include furnishings for the instructional studio. Did I see that in there?
It does include furnishings for the instructional studio.
Okay, so I just, that was.
I'm sorry, you know, I was trying to make a point there. And what I was trying to draw a connection to, when we went through this process, we actually made, we planned all of the FF&E for all of the classrooms. What we did not plan for is the instructional studio originally. But when I did the walkthrough through the new building, it dawned on me that we actually, when we were probably like maybe a month, we actually did not have FF&E for the instructional studio. And my point is, at times you try to plan for everything, but you don't really know until you actually get into your, I use the analogy of the house, but we do have equipment now for the instructional studio, but I was just trying to make that connection.
Okay, and then my other, thank you. My other question is, so we're at currently, did I understand 2.1?
2.17, but that's less 20%. So it's really about 1.17. What you're going to probably spend if we go out at 2.1 would be 1.738 plus or minus,
which is still over our 1.6.
Yes, ma'am.
And we can, yes, but we can adjust that. We can adjust that 25%. Is that the number on which the 25 is based?
Yeah, your number is really going to be 1.73. Yeah, because my number's inflated.
Right, but I'm asking in terms of the statute, 25% adjustment that you mentioned, is that over the actual, that an adjustment to the actual bid number? So if it comes in at 1.7, we can go up or down 25%?
You can add or subtract quantities based on that bid number.
Right.
It's not based upon the budgeted amount of.
My budget number is mine, exactly. My budget number is going to be high. So that's not a quote real number for a bid. So really where we really are today with real dollars is 1.738-ish.
Ish. So as I understand it, by including the wrestling mats in the bidding process, we're not making any commitment to buy wrestling mats. We're just getting a price.
Right, and wrestling mats are, I mean, really what happens when these come in and you, let's say you say to us, we don't have the money, we're not buying the wrestling mats. That's a deduct of about $26,000 to $30,000 gone. And that's a good deduct. I mean, it's if you got bigger deducts, it's easier to get the number down. Just the same thing with the furniture. I estimate, because I've seen it in other schools, Plymouth is an example. That's an $80,000 add for the fancy stuff. So it's a real quick deduct if you guys decide you don't have the money when the bid comes in. So, I mean, we've already done this a couple times where to get down to get 170 out of this, we had estimated cuts of 26.2 for the wrestling mats, 60 for fitness equipment, which we don't want to do, 80 for classroom furniture, and library end panels at $11,000. So there's $177,000 in deducts we know we have if we have to use them.
And on the tables and the desks and chairs, you can mix and match.
We can,
not
and
within
spray
classrooms,
water
but
to
I mean,
that.
You could do
right.
that if you chose to.
Right.
If you saw some savings.
Yeah. Cards.
What do you mean mix and match?
Well, you don't. If you don't
chose
that,
have
that classroom. Desk, it wouldn't have to be every classroom having that desk if you wanted. Mm-hmm. I'm not advocating. I'm just saying that's another area of flexibility.
Or you can buy the hard plastic chair and you can buy that desk.
Right.
Or you can buy that desk and the older desk. And, I mean, there's a lot of options.
So is there a shot at going out to this bid and still come, going out with a bid proposal as you currently have it, and still coming in at $1.6 million?
If you take the deducts off, yes. It's the same kind of thing where I was with East Hampton a year ago, where they had $600,000 to spend. I gave them a 20% markup. I think they needed to be at like eight something. They were at a million. And they thought they were gonna throw $1 million on the street and come in at six. And I told them they weren't, and they came in at 800,000.
No.
So with this number, you're not gonna get to six.
Well, that's what I'm asking. We're not gonna get to 1.6.
But
we're
gonna
have to knock
those other things out. But we know how we can get it to 1.6 if we have to. It's not what we wanna do, but if you guys don't wanna allocate some contingency money for it, or you don't have that contingency money, we know how we can get there. We don't want to do it.
Yeah, I think this is, I mean, the first step is you want to see those actual
numbers.
And then that's, put it on the street, bring it in.
Yeah.
And I think when the bids come back, we're going to have a lot better idea where we are in contingency.
Yeah.
You see, mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, and see if there's value to the committee to
right.
Propose it.
Correct.
And the timetable allows the time to do that.
Okay, the timetable right now, just I want to go over it with you guys because okay. We've lost some time. Sign off by the end of December. I want 1 month to process the document. It's a bid document, so there are still holes in it, like the language lab. Stephanie and I talked about that tonight. Right now I'm carrying a number that'll carry the furniture, whether it goes language lab furniture or it goes computer lab furniture. It doesn't matter. But I don't have enough data to put it on the street, so I've got to fill holes. So I need a month to do that. So that's the month of January. The bid time is going to be February, 4 weeks. February beginning to end. Then the bid comes in the end of February. The month of March, we do the bid analysis. And by the end of March, we need to cut the POs. Your manufacturing time is April, May, and June. You install in July.
Cutting it close.
It is close. And
question.
I know
yes,
that.
Sir.
Go ahead. Sorry about
that. Is furniture American made?
Yes, sir.
Chairs included?
Yes.
I got one.
All the components?
As far as I know, yes.
Dumb question, but.
That's okay.
Where do you put the books?
You can put a book basket, but in high schools they typically don't. These have book bag hooks on them, the desk. Yeah. On this one, there's one that does. They have a hook on it that you can hang a bag on.
Or they just go on the floor.
Or they go on the floor. We do have that chair over there is actually a book bag chair, the hard
right,
plastic.
Right, right.
And we put that in the Quincy Middle School this year. Because they didn't spend extra money on furniture. They went with the old-fashioned stuff.
I think in 10 years, you're not going to have books.
Probably 5 years.
I mean,
but it's a good thought, though.
I mean, Dan mentioned, I mean, these are actually good, too. I mean, because if you have, you know, someone that's in a wheelchair or whatever,
oh,
they
yeah,
go
well,
up
I,
and down.
I like the
these are adjustable.
Material.
Yeah.
I like the way it's laid out. It looks like
they're actually adjustable.
Durable stuff.
It's more conducive to how learning is being done these days in classrooms, where it's in a group setting instead of individual. So, but with
maybe
that said,
either way,
Mr. Chairman, I would like to make a motion that we allow this to go out to bid as is.
Second.
Okay, motion second. Further discussion? The only thing I will say is that with the amount of the overage here, I personally have a concern in how much it'll eat up our contingency, but we'll deal with that when that time comes. So.
I'm right there with you, Mr. Chairman.
Okay.
When you get the final bids, is there an option to pick and choose what you want?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
It's different than construction.
I would just reiterate the same thing, just worried about what we still have to face down the road with abatement and whatnot. So I would love to put the best in there, but I think that if we can get at least the numbers back, we'll make a sound decision in the future.
Anyone else? And I'm on board for spending the money.
Yeah.
You don't want to get a new building and spend all that money. And don't go the whole
route. Appreciate it.
Spend it, put it in there. If we need more money, we'll find it. Okay.
I like your thought.
I thought I'd hear those words come out of your mouth, Robert.
I'm right there with you, buddy.
We need more money, you find it.
Can I just say, I agree with the motion, and I'll vote in favor of the motion. I think we should think about expanding the subcommittee so that when the bid comes in, we can have a group that looks very seriously at exactly what we're going to spend and how we might look at it to adjust things so that we come as close to the budget amount as we possibly can. So I think great work has been done, but I think in looking and coming to the final decision, I think we should have more members of our building committee on a subcommittee that looks at it.
What happened in East Bridgewater is, and we went over this, is, and you all weren't here, but that client's, I call it salt and peppering in the end. They kept throwing stuff in it, and they were already over budget. So when it went out, it came back in, and they didn't have the money. So we had to sit down with them and go through, what do you want to cut? And I'm more than happy to do that with you as many times as we need to do it to get you where you want to be with a number. And what happens is we meet, we talk about those cuts, and then I go back and I make the cuts, and then I generate a new dollar amount for you. That's the best way to do it. And I'm more than happy to work with your committee to do that when the numbers come in. I can also run it a couple different scenarios, like the preferred and the alternate, so you can see the differences in what you're paying. So as many meetings as we need to do that.
Yeah, I don't think we need to have a subcommittee at all. I think the decision should be made with the full committee at this stage in the game, once we have hard numbers.
But what I'd like to...
I don't think it's practical to have the entire committee sitting and deciding how many conference room chairs of one type we're going to buy and how many conference room chairs of another type we're going to buy. And we're going to have two different types of conference room chairs with different prices, and we can save some money. I think those are the kinds of things that we're going to have to look at.
I'd like to do it before we present to the committee to get where you guys want it to be. And that needs to be a group of people sitting at a conference table working it out. So that's the...
Well, I didn't realize we were bidding alternate conference room chairs.
Well, the teachers prefer the larger... I showed two chairs. They prefer the larger chair, so I'm going to bid it as the larger chair is the preferred and the smaller is the alternate. You'll save a couple bucks. Same thing with workstations. We're going to show them as a standard and try to save some money that way too. So there are ways that we can save money. What I'd like to do when the numbers come in and I have an unqualified number for you guys is sit down and go, okay, what happens with this bid is it's a lot of stuff. Like you've got gym equipment, you've got medical equipment, you've got life skills equipment, large quantities of that stuff, a lot of items, 1,000 items. So what I do is I go through the bid and in the beginning of it, I will make an unqualified award. That means it's not qualified, but it will at least give us a sense of where we are dollar-wise. At that point, and I'll continue to work on qualifying all the bids, because I have to go through every section of work and make sure that the vendor meets the spec. And if they don't, I award to another vendor. So at that point, when we have an unqualified number, it's pretty much going to stay that way. It might go up or down 10%. Then we should start those meetings where you guys have a sense of where you want to be, and we know what the numbers are, even if it's unqualified, to try to get it to the point where we say, okay, we can afford to buy this. We have to take these things out. And then I can start taking those out at the same time I'm qualifying it. So in the 4-week time, we're ready to cut purchase orders.
Yeah. So it's a focus group, so.
It's a process.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So, I mean, I don't have any opposition. I think it's a good idea to have that. So I don't think we have to establish who sits on that tonight, but anyone who might have an interest in sitting on it should let me know and we'll set that up.
Okay. And the motion was made by?
Myself.
Second by Mark.
Are we going to include the existing group with that, or?
Oh yeah.
So you're going to have all the faculty and whatnot involved, and then just add a few more members of the building committee.
I didn't know that we established an FF&E committee that included all of the content coordinators. I think. Well, I don't remember that happening, but in any event, we can work that
yeah,
out.
Yeah, it seems, well, my interpretation would be
it would turn it into a political story.
They probably, of course, you'd be included.
Yeah.
The content coordinators have been meeting with Nancy, myself, Brian, for quite some time.
and to sit and meet as an entire group for the science department, FF&E, is a waste of time for the math department. So what the FF&Es have been a series of extensive meetings with each department for sometimes a couple of hours, if not longer, over the last year and a half. Once we've gone through the entire program, once we've gone through the equipment, we decide whether what qualifies for FF&E and what qualifies for technology. Once we decipher all that out, we've met at a committee and say, okay, what are we looking for in our common areas? What types of desks are we looking for in our general classrooms? So the last time the FF&E was convened, you were there, I believe you were there. Mr. Pierce was there. I think, John, you were there. It was in the morning. We actually started talking a little bit about the process and the next steps and some of the recommendations. So the FF&E, I'll just share this with you. The current FF&E does not have the flexibility to meet after school. They've been doing it on their own time at 7 a.m. when Nancy gets here, and certainly meeting times would have to be in the daytime. Certainly, if there's another subcommittee of that, I don't know in terms of how that would be facilitated and who's going to coordinate that. I'm not saying that it can't happen. I'm saying that there's going to be a little bit more. I'm just not sure what the subcommittee is going to be charged with. If that means the content coordinator is going to be part of that, or is it going to be a building committee?
Well, I'm not going to speak for Mr. Pierce, but what I envisioned was would be a building committee subcommittee, which would include yourself, John, and then whomever else might want to be participating in that. And it's not to reinvent the wheel, if you will, but kind of get a comfort level and review what the options are. That's how I envision it anyway. I don't know that
I wouldn't think that it would be content specific. In other words, if the science department has basically identified what equipment, lab materials they need, that's probably set. We're talking in terms of type of desk we're going to purchase, the type of chair we're going to purchase, the type of conference room furniture, those kinds of issues where we're able to tweak the amounts and try to come as close to our budget as we can. That's what I would envision.
Well, the motion on the floor right now is to move forward with the bid as it's presented. The understanding we'll have a review and I guess we'd have a separate motion to establish that subcommittee, but the motion on the floor right now is regarded to the bid. Is there any more discussion related to the bid? Okay, all in favor?
Aye.
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 Any opposed? Thank you. All right, next up, the subcommittee idea.
I suggest we defer it until the next meeting. We have a little more discussion about it, so we know it's
all right, good time.
Workable.
Yep.
All right, I know that Mr. Souza had given me until 7:10, I think.
And we'll get some.
What I'd ask we could do now is if you go, if you want to get the invoices approved while we have a quorum. So in the package that we had from Stansker, third page in with the blue heading, with the invoice page. Mm-hmm. I'll state as I always try to that the thank you, Nancy, by the way. Sorry.
That's okay.
You
guys all have a Merry Christmas.
Thank you.
Thank you.
The page, blue lettered top, outlines the invoices for this month. Dan, did you want to make any comments on this?
No, that's
these
fine.
These have all been reviewed by the construction subcommittee and recommended for approval by the building committee. And so I'd entertain a motion to...
Do you want the total or do you want to take them separately?
I think it's better to take them separately.
Okay. Make a motion to approve. I can't read it, it's too small. I can give you the total, but I can't read that one.
I can't read the others either.
That one's probably going to be good enough because that's what's on the warrant anyway.
Make a motion to approve the AI3. I need glasses too.
Thanks, Dan.
$15.47.
Okay, so if John makes the motion, I'll second it.
I'll talk to Mike about this.
Okay, so we have a motion and second for the AI3 invoice, the amount of $15,461.57. Any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
All right, next up, I'd seek a motion to approve for...
Skanska. 3-2-3...
No, that one's for Bacon Agostini.
Yeah, Bacon Agostini, right. $3,230,833.
Thank you. Should we have a second?
Second.
Motion is second. Any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Skanska.
So $72,960.
Oh, I could read that one.
I have a motion. Is it second?
Second.
Okay.
All right.
I'll give it to you, John.
Discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
And what else?
It's got extra services.
Sixth, okay.
$9,582.10.
All right, that's the motion.
Second.
Second. Discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Very good. One more?
Make a motion for Unibank, $1,000.
Second.
Motion is second. Any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Thank you, that takes care of that. Now, in the same packet, further back, is a page that is yellow highlighted, representing change order number 14, right?
And there's an explanation of each of the change order requests on the following page.
And these, in all cases, these invoices and change orders have been distributed to the committee in advance of the meeting for review. So, these, I think that we could entertain as a change order total amount, as shown here, of $23,665.
So moved.
No, second.
The motion is second. Is there discussion on the change orders? You all had a chance to read these at night and enjoyed them thoroughly. And no discussion. All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Okay, thank you. Again, as I say, all these things have been reviewed prior to the meeting by individual members. If they have questions, they have the opportunity to bring them to us tonight or directly to the project manager.
Mr. Chairman, I apologize. I do have a prior engagement. I wish everybody a happy holiday.
Thank you. Mr. Susan. Thank you for coming out.
Thank you.
Appreciate it.
See you later.
Okay. Thank you, Mr. O'Neill. And, you know, the rescheduling here made it very difficult for us to hold it, get a quorum in here. We had some business we wanted to get done as quickly as we could. So right now, we have lost a quorum. But we are going to continue this as an informational meeting. The committee will take no formal action.
I was just going to ask you that, did we need to vote on that IP tonight?
No, we can wait for the next one to get the ball rolling. Okay. But it would have been nice to have it voted, but no, we're not under tonight's deadline. But we could go through some of the, it's up to you.
I had kind of bounced Lindsay further down the financing. So I'd ask Lindsay wants to do the financing piece now, and then we'll kind of follow the agenda. And for those who don't know, this is Lindsay Albernez, who's the treasurer for the school district.
First of all, thank you for having me to speak. I'm just going to take 5 minutes to do a quick overview about the finances of the project. You should be looking at, and not, sorry about the small print now. I won't bring it up next time.
Yeah.
I'm sorry. So I just wanted to give you the cash flow projection analysis as of, it says December 2013 on the bottom line, but it really is, I just gave you that line for informational purposes so that you could see that we are estimating a $4 million borrowing for January, so I wanted to include that in there. But you really want to pay attention to the November 13 line, which is November 2013. I gave you cumulative expenditures to date, which is the fourth column over, roughly about $47 million. As of November of 2013. That includes tonight's invoices that you're approving. Giving you further information, I wanted to show you what's been submitted to the MSBA to date. You kind of have to jump up one to the October because we haven't done the November line yet. I'll be doing that tomorrow morning and getting it over to Skanska to submit for reimbursement. The turnaround time for reimbursements currently is about 3 weeks, and depending on when the building committee meets and the school committee meets, it's been consistently 3 weeks to date. So so you can kind of see where you see actual reimbursement cumulative under the MSBA section. It's about 25.9 million to date we've been reimbursed. The furthest column to the right is the actual percentage of reimbursements to date. So you can see kind of the flux of those. We did have a big drop in July and August due to the fields, the turf work, all that stuff, which was not considered an eligible cost for reimbursement. Additionally to that, you'll see the borrowing columns. To date, if we include the $4 million short-term issuance that will be dated January 9th, 2014, we have borrowed $26.7 million in short-term bond anticipation notes. So that's where we are fiscally at this point. You want to jump to the second page of the presentation. This was taken from the November 13th, 2013 school committee finance presentation. I've kind of updated it to include that $4 million right at the bottom, and you can see as far as the cumulative amounts we've borrowed, the bands can renew every year annually, so you can see the ones that have renewed. The first five that are in the negative are the ones that we've paid down by borrowing new amounts. And on the far right corner, you'll see the favorable interest rates that we've gotten to take advantage of to date. Their interest rates, they're not set in stone, so we're hoping that they kind of stay pretty favorable over the next year, especially for the long-term borrowing portion. The district currently is the district's currently using only bond anticipation notes. We've been rolling them every year, like I said, and the interest is due annually when they're up for renewal. And we do work that into the budget on an annual basis. So the cumulative borrowing, where are we now? Second page is kind of just some definitions for you as far as short-term borrowing. Bond anticipation notes, you can read that at your option. The fourth page talks about options A versus B. This is what was presented to the regional school district to decide how we want to start paying off those short-term bands. At some point, we have to start paying them off. The bands have a two-year life before we have to actually start paying principal on them. So the goal is to roll those in to long-term borrowings to pay off over a longer extended time. The options were A, do multiple bond issuance to maintain bank qualified status. The option B was to issue two large bonds and stay not bank qualified status. And you can see on the, it's labeled page 6 behind it, the definition of bank qualified, basically anyone who's bidding on the bond is able to deduct any interest income from their tax return. So staying bank qualified gives us more of a favorable interest rate for those people because they're willing to charge us a lower interest rate to stay bank qualified. So we thought that was a better option at that point. We have continued to be bank qualified up until today. So we kind of want to keep that going. We've been, as you can see, we've been getting favorable interest rates.
According to the Fed, that's going to continue for the next 2 or 3 years. So really not a bad idea. You can lock some of these bond companies in for long term.
Let's hope the rates stay good. That's all we can go with. So at the last school committee meeting, the regional school district's committee voted option A to do four smaller long-term borrowing. Again, page 6, just some more definitions as bank qualified status if you want to read those. And then finally on the last page is basically a snapshot of the total long-term borrowing that we're gonna need to finance our portion of the $82 million project, minus any of the MSBA reimbursements, which we estimated to be about $32 million. Like I said, we have $26.7 million in short-term borrowing that we have to pay off, we're estimating another, we're estimating another $6 million of additional costs that we're gonna have to cover, so that's what brought us up to $32 million. This is kind of just a time frame. February 2014 is our first long-term borrowing that we're gonna be doing. Jumps us to August, down to November, and then all the way through July of 2015, which will pay off all of our bands at that point, and we will be considered fully long-term borrowed. And the school committee did also vote to use a term of 25 years. They looked at 20, 25, and 28. They got some opinions from the Town of Berkley Selectmen and Finance Committee, the Town of Somerset Board of Selectmen and Finance Committee, and they kind of made a decision based off what everyone was comfortable for as far as the term rate, or term length, I should say. So that's where we are now. In February of 2014, we will be doing our first bond issue. So we've been working on the paperwork over the last week to get that in place, and we'll get that ball rolling very shortly. So hopefully the rates come in. That's what we can do.
When both communities voted debt exclusion, when you voted 20 years, if you're gonna go past that, you have to go back to another vote.
They didn't vote the term at that time.
No, as a matter of fact,
we were looking to options.
When we were talking about giving examples of the funding, you presented various scenarios of 20, 25, and 28 years, because the legislature, it used to be that you were limited to 20 years, and the legislature extended it to 30 years. So we could, but in fact, the maximum is really 28 years because of the 2-year short-term borrowing that we're doing. So we are limited to a maximum term of 28, but.
I know people in Berkley voted and knew they were paying for 20 years for a debt exclusion. If it goes out to 28 with the increase in taxes to cover this, people are going to have a problem.
It's not 28. 25.
It's 5 more years than 20.
But I'm surprised, because we had our meeting with, we had members of the Finance Committee here.
No, I'm sure they didn't realize at the time, but I'm telling them this vote was done at Berkley. Everybody figured, because the last school we built was a 20-year term. Debt exclusion is always 20 years.
It's a matter of if the language was in the motion or if it was...
I don't know if it is. I'll go back and look, but I can tell you a lot of people are going to have a stroke over 25 years. So more than 20, they're going to have a stroke.
I think the 25 was the preferred option for the Berkley group. That's why I understood it. I'm not sure.
When the information that we received from Berkley was that, actually from the chairman of the Finance Committee, that his personal preference was 20 years, but he felt that there were many people in Berkley that preferred the 28 years because it would provide for the smallest annual payment. And so as a result of that input and the same type of input that we received from Somerset, where the Advisory and Finance Committee was polled, and they, of the people that responded, there were 3 people that preferred a 20-year term and 3 people that preferred a 28-year term. The committee opted for 25 years for the initial borrow in February. We can lengthen the term or reduce the term on the subsequent borrowings. We didn't commit to a 25-year term for every bond issue. We committed to the first one to be 25 years.
So I'll go back and ask the conversations, and at the next meeting I'll have some answers. But when would this hit the tax rolls as we're at right now?
The principal and interest would have to start being paid in fiscal year 15.
So no one's gonna see the taxes going up till 2015, the first.
The scenario that, and part of the reason that we went for the scenario that we did, is that there'll be some impact in fiscal 15. It will really not be anywhere near the full cost. There'll be a greater impact in fiscal 16, and the full impact won't be felt until fiscal 17.
So we're looking at 2037 before this is paid off.
depending on what the term is for the subsequent borrowings.
We'll take a look at that.
Yeah, I'd like to know. That was the first time I'd even heard that.
You know what, there's a group of folks in town that really pay attention to this kind of stuff, and it's always, oh, you lied, or you misled, or you this. From what I know, from when we passed this, it was a 20-year deal.
There was no term on the vote.
I don't believe there was, and I'm sure, I know that Mr. Hope was the chairman of the Finance Committee at the time of the override vote, correct? And was Mr. Larrabee part of the Finance Committee at that time as well? Because we spoke at length with both of them about it, and neither one of them raised any concern that anything more than a 20-year term would be a problem. So we'll take another look at the vote. Those votes were prepared by bond counsel, and I don't remember that there was any reference to the term. As a matter of fact, I remember talking with bond counsel about the fact that we could borrow anywhere between 20 and 28 years, and the fact that the statute changed. Previously, the longest you could borrow was 20 years, and the legislature changed that and increased it to 30 years. So,
what did the bond counsel prefer in her estimation of the time frame?
Well, bond counsel, the attorney, never expressed any opinion about what the preferable term was, and nor did actually our financial advisor really didn't express a preference. I mean, we took at the meetings that the school committee had, at which the public officials from both Berkeley and Somerset were present. There are advantages to both. It's less expensive to borrow for the shorter term.
Absolutely. Quicker you pay it, less you pay. The longer it drags out, more you can beat on interest.
Right. And that's right.
And who knows what interest is going to be in 20 years from now. That last 8 years could be a killer.
Mm-hmm. Well, the interest rate will be fixed when the bonds are issued. The interest, it's not a variable interest rate. The interest rate will be fixed.
Only going
when
to
we
25,
borrow.
We're not going to 8.28.
Nobody knows what the future holds.
Yeah, right. I mean, if you're in here at like a percent and a half today, 20 years from now, it's, 15 or 18%. People who own these bonds are going to be like, hey, wait a minute.
Yeah. Well, that's
what I be.
That's why longer term bonds have a little higher interest rate, but they buy the bond with the interest rate fixed. There's nothing they can do about it. If interest rates increase significantly, then
make them up on the new bond.
Doesn't change the amount of interest that we have to pay. It's the same.
Well, I think the short for me is the fact that the MSBA is reimbursing so quickly is great news, because we don't have to expend that money.
If it was delayed anymore, we probably would have had to do it sooner.
Yeah. So. You think about the old days when the old school building authority, you'd be waiting a long time if you didn't to borrow it all.
Right.
So that and the lowest interest, yeah. And the low rates is a great combo.
Yeah, and I think it's great that our treasurer has been able to, get the filings done with the MSBA so that we are getting regular, timely reimbursements, and we haven't had to. I mean, we're still borrowing a significant amount, but we have cash flow issues if we weren't processing these reimbursement requisitions promptly, and that's why it's important for us, for the school committee, to approve these requisitions as well as the building committee as quickly as possible and get them.
I agree. Thank you, Lindsay.
Yeah.
Thank you, Lindsay.
Thank you.
Any other questions for Lindsay? Anyone accept? Thank you very much, Lindsay.
Thank you.
Sorry to hold you up. Yeah. Okay. All right, next up we'll have Stephanie
You want to talk about the technology subcommittee update?
Just briefly, because I know we don't have a full group here, I think it would be beneficial to do the presentation when we do have a quorum, but know that the subcommittee has come to a recommendation for the voiceover IP system. And I'm happy to answer any specific questions you have right now, but I think it's best to wait for the full presentation when we have a quorum. If there's any specific questions, I know Rich did circulate documents based on our recommendation and also the bid itself, but we can go over that in further detail when we have a quorum.
And as far as the timing goes for that, the next building committee meeting will be, will work?
Yes.
Yes.
Yep.
Yes. Not ideal, but it will work, right?
It will work. There's no decisions with the reseller or the vendor at this point that holds up anything from a construction perspective on that. The other thing that I did want to bring everyone up to speed on is that TechEdge has completed their RFQ for the rest of the owner-provided technology. At our last subcommittee meeting, he's not here tonight, but for the purpose of the rest of the building committee, Steve Levesque, who's the new integration specialist and network manager, has been working very closely over the past couple of months with AI3 and also with some of the other vendors. And so we're going to be working with Steve Levesque as the lead on that to help us with the owner-provided technology, so we'll be moving forward with that as well. At the next building committee meeting, we'll also have printer-copier proposal as well. If you all remember, under owner-provided technology, we broke it into three phases. It was the voice-over IP, copier, and then the rest of the owner-provided technology. Dr. Mosley and I will also be working closely together to iron out some of the other things that have to do with owner-provided technology from a computer perspective as well.
Okay, very good. Thank you.
Can I ask
yes,
a question?
Yes.
I thought that you, Dr. Mosley, alluded to an issue about the language lab.
We're going to explore
what
that.
What is that issue?
We're going to explore that further to after tonight's meeting. It was the first that I heard of it. So there is an issue regarding software and where that lands in the budget itself. So the owner-provided technology list that we were currently working off of, we do incorporate software into that. So Dr. Mosley and I are going to have a discussion about software, because not only will it affect the language lab, but it may also affect some other areas as well.
And that's content specific, so we're going to have, I'm going to follow up with the content coordinator, Mrs. Mm-hmm. Erica Pereira, and get her feedback on some of the software that she's been currently researching. The second piece that popped up during our discussion had to do with FF&E, and Nancy was looking for some clarification on that. Basically, there's two types of furniture. One is basically kind of almost like a desk that's pretty flat and pretty standard, that you could just put a regular desktop on it and just go like straight across like a row. And the second piece is that some of the, like, I think it's Millwood has the very traditional carousel foreign language labs, where it's pretty, you are enclosed in this type of device, I want to say, or type of concoction, and you're facing the screen and it's very, very private. Most labs now are very different, so we have to decide on whether we're going to just have a traditional language lab where we just kind of have rows of computers, or we're going to go with the, I would say, the carousel
cubicle.
But it's a little different than a cubicle. It's like a carousel. You're very isolated, and you're in front of like one computer, and you're in.
I don't like that.
Okay. We didn't give Nancy enough information to decide on what the FF&E was for that, and she wanted some follow-up information, some direction.
And one of the things that we were talking about, and Dr. Mosley and I are going to start ironing this out, and we're very fortunate that we have Steve Levesque now on staff because of his networking expertise, is that looking at this cloud computing, so whereas things were done traditionally, can we move to a more sustainable model where instead of investing in those actual desktops, are there other options we can do that's going to satisfy the curriculum needs, but maybe a bit more sustainable going
forward?
They're
flexible for the kids, teachers, everything. Flexible platform is always the best.
One of the things we just bumped up against was with the voiceover IP system, was virtualizing that and the cost savings that we recognize from a central management perspective, and not to get too much into the presentation, but from central management and also from seamless growth. So by putting in a system like this, virtualizing it, using the high school as a hub down the road, it's stackable. You can build on buildings from that. So there's options than going just the typical, but Dr. Mosley and I have to coordinate, because I don't believe, and I tell me if I'm wrong, but that the building committee's decision to make any type of decisions based on curriculum but we're here to support those, but to give options as to how maybe we can.
Flexibility is the way to go. If we're going to compete with kids around the world, we've got to stop thinking about, you know, the traditional way we've done things here for the last 4 years. Throw it out, get rid of it, and start fresh with how we're going to compete in the world. Give these kids half a chance.
There is some overlap here, and it sounds a little confusing. It's not. It's just that there are certain components where there's some networking pieces that fall in the realm of Stephanie. There's the IP voiceover that falls in the realm of Stephanie. There is curriculum software that comes back and falls in my realm as the principal, which falls in the realm of the content coordinator. So all of these services need to be coordinated and worked out. So that's where we're kind of been talking about making sure that we're on the same page and things are being communicated effectively.
And what's
My question is, and it certainly is curriculum related, but I serve in dual roles, both as a member of the school committee and as a member of the building committee. And if we're talking about eliminating a language lab from this project, I'd like to know about it. I mean, a language, the technology. Okay, I just want to.
No.
Well, we're talking about eliminating furniture that's designed for a language lab.
We have to decide on what type of furniture. Decide. There's two types of furniture. There's like a row, kind of like a flat table that goes straight across. You just slide the computers up. Or there's the other option is the carousel one. It's very individualized.
Right. And there's a reason why it's really individualized, because in a language lab, a student sits there and verbalizes the language. And so I don't know how you can have a language. And again, I'd be the first one to acknowledge that, you know, I'm not an educator.
You've got a platform.
I just want to be sure I consider, you know, the foreign language program extremely important in a global society, and I just want to make sure that we have. I mean, I thought that there was specialized equipment in a language lab so that the instructor can tune in to each individual student and hear what they're saying in terms of verbalizing the language. So if there is any discussion about eliminating that type of facility in the building, I'd just like to make sure we have a full ranging discussion about that before it occurs. Well, I understand it's a curriculum issue, but
when I attended the MASQ conference, that was actually one of the things that was discussed, that because of this, everything being cloud-based, and there was some people raising hands, can you even do that with a language lab? And they said yes. So to your point, I think that I agree we should have that discussion should it change from what our initial intention was. But if at all possible, we should look at what the latest iteration of that is, rather than locking us into what the traditional format. Because what we're, you know, if we went to a conference not too long ago and they're already saying, well, that's passé, we're now doing it this way, we have the opportunity to look at what that new way is. And it may, I don't want to say it may save us money, it may allow us to move resources into other areas that where it might be needed. So I think we should have the discussion, but I mean, this isn't new. I have heard that there are different ways of doing that, and I think it has to be kind of a discussion that happens both in the curriculum level and also on the budget level, because it will have ramifications.
Just a point of clarification, the language labs that Norwood built look very differently now, and there's no question about that. Yeah. We may want to go the route of Norwood. We may want to move in that direction in terms of MASQ. We're not moving in terms of elimination, only because the curriculum doesn't dictate that. Common Core standards dictates that minimum you have to have to graduate now to complete the Common Core, a minimum of 2 years of the same language. That's just the minimum. So to kind of come full circle, I think that the integration of a world language is a necessity for graduation, so there will never be an elimination. And in fact, it would always be support for that. It's just the format,
right? The room,
the curriculum, and what that looks like, and the FF&E to support that format and that vision of what that looks like.
Okay. one of the advantages they talked about at that conference was flexibility.
Yes.
That if it's not your standard language lab, but that you're still able to do everything you need to do, it now becomes another lab
yes,
that yeah. can be used for a variety yeah. of issues. So I think
especially
it's worth
with
looking Tom. At. Yeah, especially with that. So I think it's worth looking at.
In those boxes.
I would just like to hear about this. I mean, I understand the difference between the cloud and having the software, you know, in on site, but that's an entirely different issue from the physical facility of whether you have a dedicated language lab as opposed to teaching foreign language in a computer lab. And that's my concern, and I just want to make sure that we understand what decision is being made with respect to that before this furniture is ordered.
Mm-hmm. Mr. Pierce, do you think it would be helpful as we start to move forward with more technology? Because the stuff that we're doing right now is very building specific. Would it be helpful to have reports to the full building committee, or since there we've seen such overlap now with the purchases that we're going to make on the building side, but that do affect curriculum. Do you think that's something that would be helpful? Would you rather have more represent? What would be helpful?
I think when decisions like the one that we're talking about are being made, that we should be informed as to what the issues are and you know, what the recommendation is.
Okay.
Just after this discussion around the foreign language came to our attention
tonight.
So we were not sitting on it whatsoever. There's the three of us, Stephanie and Nancy. We were in the corner. We're talking briefly about FF&E and then the discussion. Remember Nancy said, and this goes back to moving into the house, how it's not perfect, how this is always going to be a variable you just can't see. This is another hole that Nancy just came across. Approached Stephanie about it, and then I had some commentary, and I still have some follow-up to do with the content coordinator around the issue around curriculum and software, and I would certainly get back to Stephanie and document that process. So this has not been a long-standing issue. It's something that came up just within the last hour, and we're going to address it, but in no way are we eliminating anything. We're just making sure that the foreign language lab, as it has been defined by the program of studies, by the space summary, by the matrix of the building, gets the proper FF&E, and we, from the technology perspective, order the correct equipment and software to support the curriculum. Fair enough?
Mm-hmm. I think I'm just going to add, not to this specifically, but as we get closer to the finish line, if you will. I think there's more of these areas that are a little bit gray where they're kind of the curriculum in the building, because the beginning stages, it was pretty clear cut. The building committee had a role. They're going to put up this building and follow that and make sure the construction. But now as you're getting closer to completion, there's more places where decisions that are made are impacting the curriculum or the program where if you make a change. And I think the more we communicate that at these meetings, the better. And I think that might is a good suggestion, is that as we go through this, maybe we have a little bit more extended conversation on some of the things that are happening, so everyone kind of has a clear understanding of where we're going and if any concerns can be raised then.
Well, it's my experience is that we try to give as much lead time as possible so that representatives of the school committee can hear it here, but then go back and meet with their full committee to make those types of decisions that are going to impact curriculum or education or whatever, because it really shouldn't be a vote of this committee to determine that. It should be the vision of the school committee.
Right. Mm-hmm.
Sorry.
Okay. We all set? Anything else?
Unless there's any other questions,
yeah. All right. Thanks. Julie?
Do you want me to give you a brief report? Are we going to
sure.
or not?
Oh, sure.
Are we going to the communications report, or are we going back to something?
Well, we have other stuff, but if you want to give a communications report, you go.
Very briefly.
Everybody's on a short. Because of rescheduling, everybody's kind of on a tight schedule here. Dan, this is holiday party.
Dan's sitting last.
Dan's
sitting last.
Mike's there in my place.
Just leave, Dan.
I know.
That's in Boston.
They can make it, huh? It's in Boston now.
There's no traffic going up there.
He didn't need that much sympathy, just do what
he likes to fly in the rain.
Okay.
Very briefly, so that everyone knows, the time capsule is about 99% complete. We were scheduled to transfer it over to the project team this Tuesday, but that was canceled. So we'll look to have it after the new year, shortly after the new year, is within that week, if at all possible. I did speak to Mike Morrison this week, and it was we could not have the project team available for today to have it done. So we have just one layer of photos and a couple of other documents, and it should be done. So I want to thank that committee publicly for all their work in that. Did a great job. And we have, in early January, January 13th, I believe, a meeting of the Raiders Remember Committee planning event. And that's the event that will say goodbye to this building before it's demolished. So a good group working on that as well.
Okay. Thank you. All right, next up, Dan, I think it's you.
Well, great. Wonderful.
And feel free to run rapidly through your...
Yeah, that's fine. I think we can be pretty quick. In fact, we've already talked about budget. We've already talked about the change orders. Thanks. And... So really, just bring everybody up to speed on where we are. In terms of the schedule, overall schedule is approximately 65% complete through the month of November. On average, it's been about 130 construction workers. You know, the areas of the building that they've been focused on, obviously, is in the academic wing. We'll have some images. We'll take you through the slideshow that shows you some of the progress being made. A lot of progress has been made in the last month. We continue to monitor the schedule. Our primary concern is just getting the masons off the project. That's what a contractor would like to see happen, because that way we know we're completely tight on the exterior and getting the work done on the interior. The masons actually just this week started doing the masonry work in the gymnasium, which is good. So we're starting to see some progress being made over there. I don't have to go through all this stuff, but basically, you know, it's just going to be a continuation of this. The site work essentially has stopped for the winter, but the interior work is going to continue to go on with finishes not only on the second level, on the third level, but also beginning on the first level as well. And again, lots of pictures on that. Quality assurance is an ongoing effort. If you've noticed, the Briggs invoice is probably about half of what it's been. They're focused primarily on masonry right now. And again, hopefully in one more month's time, we should be pretty much done with having the need for a masonry inspector on site. As it is, they're on site 3 days a week now. We just did our final fireproofing inspection this week. We're waiting on a report. And basically soils and paving inspections will take place next springtime, once we start gearing up again. I can quickly go through these other items. The next MSBA visit is the 21st of January. I know move management, there's been an effort made on that. I don't know if there's an update in terms of where the district is in terms of hiring a moving company.
I believe
you guys in the process of recommending?
Yes. And there was a meeting with the staff, optional meeting. You couldn't make them come to the meeting, but superintendent and principal met with the staff to kind of go over at very top level what the process would be like, what their responsibilities would be, what some of the tools would be used to help with the move. So there's been at least an introduction to the staff on those issues.
Good. So our goal as your OPM is that in January, once the moving company, hopefully moving companies on board at that point, is to really begin that process and set up some meetings so we can begin to coordinate that effort, because it's going to be a big effort. And it's tied in with the FF&E and the technology and everything else, so in the completing of the building. The
programming of
looking at the salvaging, or? Yeah, there's, in fact, I think I sent an email around earlier. Mark had forwarded an email on to me as well. There's a couple of companies out there that would come in and do some salvaging of equipment and furniture and things that the district no longer wants or needs, and then they basically repurpose this and donate to charity and so on. I don't know enough about it. There's only a couple of companies that I'm aware of that actually provides this kind of service. I don't even know what it costs or what the impact is.
It shouldn't cost anything. They offer you X amount of dollars to purchase the material. They liquidate it on their own.
Yeah, well.
It doesn't cost the district anything. They should keep paying up.
Paying you to take your crap out of here. I mean,
paying you to take. Absolutely. Not for nothing. I turn this stuff around. All this stuff will be on eBay.
No, it's.
In any event,
I think what we're really trying to get to is the fact that not only is the move management aspect have to take place, but also the identification of whatever isn't going to be moved anywhere, what becomes of all of this. And that's another piece that has to be coordinated.
Is the surplus furniture going to be offered to the elementary school district? Or?
Well, that's what we're talking about now, is how to deal with what's left in the building.
How to deal with the
it
surplus.
It has to be
there's a public
voted
procurement
as surplus
process.
Before you can do anything.
Right.
Right.
Okay.
Exactly. Typically, that's how it works. So we're in the process of, you know, kind of researching that a little bit. Building management, again, I know as the building continues to be completed, there's going to be the need to have a building management person or people involved in the training. Of that, and I think at that point, you know what I'll do is at that point, everything else that's on this list is actually in the presentation, so I can take care of that. What I could do, if you don't mind, I can take you through the slideshow real quick if you want. You guys all leave, huh? Do we even want to do this now? We can do this next month.
Yeah.
Oh, I can't see the thing.
I'm fine with that.
Yeah, let's just do this. If you can get,
if there's something particular that you would like
or
to see,
you know, I'm just saying if you send that to me electronically, I can get it to the whole committee so they can look at it. And then no,
it's a giant file.
Okay, all right, never mind then.
It's a giant.
Then we'll have a double update next month.
It takes 5 minutes. I can send you everything except for the videos because it's the videos that are taking up all the memory. I can send you all the other stuff that relate to the banners, to the.
Can you quickly just get to the auditorium stage and the banners?
Yes.
Oh, the auditorium. Okay.
So this is the stage floor that we own right now, and if you looked at those East Bridgewater comments in
yes.
here, there was a performance stage there that I guess was quality issues as much as anything. And what the construction subcommittee had talked about was the yellow is a what they call the performance staging. The green is a hardwood. Correct me whenever I.
That's correct. It's like an you know and, like an oak flooring or something.
Right.
Like
so the two issues with the auditorium or the two questions on the auditorium is what the flooring is going to end up being on that stage, and then if you see in the front seating there, there's one in the middle, there's one row that's a little bit ahead of the other two,
mm-hmm.
and if we need to make an alteration there for an orchestra pit, but one of the scenarios that's being priced out right now is this to have the hardwood go across the front of the stage, so if you're in front of the curtain, it would have a little bit better look. Than having the performance stage there and assuming the performance stage, which is the yellow, it's like a hardwood that's painted black, would have been installed properly and would have the issues.
Correct.
Which
correct.
Right, because
correct.
They did have some
yeah.
issues with that floor.
And that was mostly installation issues.
Yeah.
They've had to go back on
and
there
then
and
the,
provide enough spacing.
Well, no, they had I think they had issues with the floor itself on the stage.
When it was buckling or?
Yeah.
Yeah.
But they said it was because of the way they put it in.
Put it on.
That's
yeah.
That's given
yeah.
the problem.
And the front row of seats would preclude us as it does in East Bridgewater from having an orchestra.
Right. And right now there's some question of whether it's just one row or two rows in that center would have to come up. One row gives you 8 feet from the stage to the seat. And there's some question on the administration if that's enough room
right.
or not. Or yeah. if you could have, if you take out two rows in the middle, or can you spread the, I don't know, the answer to that.
That's what it looks like with, this is what you own on the contract. It's kind of hard to see. That's with one row taken out, which basically lines up all the front rows now.
Mm-hmm.
And then that one's,
you can see it all in white, which ended up would be the carpet area.
Right.
With the second row being taken in, you can see that area opens up even more.
So we're reducing the seating then in the auditorium.
Well, each row is 8 seats you take up. So you take, you know, right now.
I thought we were concerned about how little there was in there already.
If we have it there, you wouldn't be able to have some of the performances that we just even had this past week.
It's the orchestra. That's really what it comes down to.
There's no pit band. There's not enough room to have a pit band.
So that's the priority over the seating in the auditorium is what I'm hearing.
It's a question.
Okay.
Yeah.
Well, and it could be the kind of thing, and I don't need to be jumping in on this, but it could affect your FF&E budget, but you could buy a decent, you know, 16 or 20 chairs that you could then put back in its place when it's not being used for the purpose of the orchestra.
They wouldn't be hard.
Right.
You know what I mean? So it's like it gives you that flexibility, I guess, as well.
Yeah.
Losing.
Right back on your balls. Be out there folding up chairs and folding up chairs.
Did you want to see bears too?
I think that it's important that we get input from the music department about what space they would like to have between the stage and the seating, so that we can make an informed decision as to what we should do. Obviously, it's a trade-off. Between the seating capacity versus having the ability to have an orchestra below the stage. I don't know if it's possible. When they do their musical, the musical every year, I don't see how it would be possible to have the orchestra on the stage. But I think it's really an issue that we need to get input from the music department on before we make the decision. Unfortunately, I guess if we had known about this issue before, there are seating systems that where the first couple of rows could be removable. But unfortunately, we're beyond that point. The seating has already been ordered.
Yeah.
And
so I guess it's really, if you took out one row of seats, it gives you the 8 feet. Is it? Can you spread it out a little bit more, or do you need two rows? You know what I mean? Can you go further right to left? And just lose one row, or you know, you guys can work that out. But
I'm assuming you need the egress and the aisle, so you can't.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Kind of spread out too wide there and block up the aisle. So you probably have to take out the two rows.
What's going to be the final seating capacity?
It's 850, so you're going to drop it 16. So 832
is 800.
It's 800. I think.
Is it 800?
Yeah.
Is it 800?
800 plus 10 handicap seats, basically 10 areas for handicap seats. Yes. So it's a total of 810.
When do we have to make this decision?
Well,
not tonight.
Yesterday.
Not tonight.
No,
but
for next. Just for July.
No, I mean, what it comes down to is we have to give them notice early enough, because if we're going to take seating out, they have to adjust the plan for the carpeting down there.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
So
the seats have already been, they're in fabrication now.
Yeah, we own the seats.
I can just measure this one.
So you can store them and use them for repair.
But we really should come to a decision
in
the January meeting, I would think.
Yes.
Yeah.
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 Was there something else
too,
just those things?
I think that's good. I mean, the banners is
going
right.
I don't know.
I know, I think
it's
fine.
Okay.
I think it's like 15 feet.
I might be able to make it to Boston.
Okay. All right.
That concludes my report.
Well, thank you all for coming out and entertaining a motion to adjourn.
Thanks.
Motion second, all in favor? Okay, everyone have a wonderful holiday.
Thank you.
Happy New Year.
Thank you.
Merry Christmas. Thank you.